Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, we want to welcome each and every one of you to the Amazing Love broadcast. Get your seatbelts on. Today is going to be powerful. And if you were in the house, I mean, the miracles have been taking place. I mean, in fact, the Lord just has opened my eyes. It's like Jesus has been standing here and angels have been walking around with buckets and just pouring miracles on different people. And so we just release those miracles into your house, wherever you are right now, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you that you watch over to perform it in the name of Jesus, and that you impart the life of your word into each and every one of us in Jesus' name. And I thank you that we'll never be the same in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I want to talk to you today about going from ownership to occupation. Going from ownership to occupation. And what we're specifically talking about is that God has given us so many things. We read in the Bible that by the stripes of Jesus we've been healed. We were healed. We read in the Bible how that my God shall supply your every need according to his riches in glory. We read in the Bible that God says that he gives us the power to get wealth. And so many promises. Some people have these little promise boxes. And all of those promises are in the Word, and they're based upon our covenant with God. And yet how many believers are in a place where they know it belongs to them, but they're not experientially walking in it? You can own something without occupying it. You can own land without occupying it. You can own a house without occupying it. We're talking about, you know, you've got three or four homes, you don't occupy them all. Renters may be occupying them. But then there's some people that may have inherited something that they're not even aware of. They might be part of a heritage that they're not even aware of. So they have things, or they have the right to things. There's a bank account that they actually have access to that they don't even know exists, and so therefore they're not accessing it. And we've talked about this before, but I just felt it stirred up on the inside of me. You know, Jesus gave his life to establish a new covenant. He gave his life so that by the stripes of Jesus we would be healed and live in divine health. He gave his life so that we would live in abundance and enjoy the abundant life. He literally shed his blood, not just for us to go to heaven one day, but for us to live the blessed life here on earth. And yet, so it is not okay for our Savior to have given his life and paid the price, and for us not to have what he wanted us to have so badly that he gave his life for. It's not okay to not have what he wants us to have. It's not okay. It's not acceptable. Hallelujah. And so therefore it pleases the Lord. It more than pleases the Lord. What more can he do than to give his life on the cross of Calvary and then to stand? And the Bible says that he is forever interceding. So he's standing in the gap and he's praying and he's continually there. The Holy Spirit is there as our helper to help us to come into everything that God has got for us. And this is not a selfish thing. This is something, let me tell you what, people's lives depend upon us having what we need. The health that we need to go out and do what we're supposed to do, the energy that we need, the finances that we need in order to release the gospel and the good news to other people. People's lives depend upon us having what we need. So it's not about just us having more. It's an equipping where He supplies what we need for our assignments in life. Now let's look, I want to begin and look at Joshua 1, verse 3. It says, every place that the sole of your foot will tread, now God is speaking to Joshua, every place that the sole of your foot shall tread, I have given you, as I said to Moses. The New Living Translation says, I promise you what I promised Moses. Now what I want you to see here is that Joshua didn't have a new promise. God gave the promised land to Moses and to all of the people that were alive during those days with him. And yet at this particular time when God's speaking to Joshua, Moses was dead. And so many, probably millions, of the children of Israel had died in the wilderness, having owned the promised land but never occupied it. It was given to them. So they left Egypt with the wealth of Egypt, the presence of God, the miracle working power of God. They owned the promise. The promised land was theirs, but they never occupied it. Just like so many believers that own and have been given all of these things, but aren't walking in it. Hallelujah. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 2 to 3, says this: grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, as His divine power has given to us all things, say all things.
All things.
Has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us by glory and virtue. So that means everything that we need for life, everyday life, and everything that we need for our calling has been freely given to us. Has been. Not will be, has been. So in other words, if you're a born-again believer in Christ, everything that you need has already been given to you. All the money you need for your assignments in God, the health that you need, the wisdom that you need, the ability that you need. I mean, even favor with people that you need. He's given to you everything that you need. So even though you might read and say, well, my God shall supply all I need. And really that word shall supply is really that He has already given us. It's not a future tense. The only thing that makes it future tense is our receiving of it. So therefore, He has supplied. Having supplied, He shall supply. Having supplied, He shall supply. In other words, he is continually, it's like the multiplication of the loaves of the fishes. Having multiplied them, he is multiplying them. And so therefore, it's a continual thing. He's already done it, and he continues to do it, and continues to do it, and continues to do it. You have all you need today, but you shall have all you need tomorrow. Hallelujah. And so it's already, we're in a place of ownership in the new covenant. The word sozo, salvation, is prosperity, not just provision. It's divine help, not just healing. It's divine protection. It's preservation. I mean, it's all of every single blessing. Deliverance through Christ Jesus in the new covenant has been given to us. Say this with me. Say, I have everything I need in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. So now, we want to talk about and get into it here and talk about how we can go from ownership to possession. How many of you, or from ownership to occupation, how many of you are ready to occupy some things?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. To live in it. Well, I am. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Now, I want us to go to John chapter 15. And John chapter 15 is an awesome, awesome chapter. And it's one of these chapters where in the Old Covenant, you have Jesus as a teacher of the law, teaching the Old Covenant to the children of Israel. But then you have chapters like John chapter 15 where he's teaching to those under the law, but he's preparing them and telling them about the new covenant and how it's going to be. And so it's a really powerful, powerful chapter. But I want to begin and look at from verse 7 to 8. He says, if you abide in me, and we can just keep it up there. If you abide in me, now remember, he's speaking to the children of Israel under the old covenant, so they're not abiding in him. This is something that they are not able to do at that point. They have to go to the temple, and they can't even go into the temple. Only a certain amount of people can go into the temple. So it's real foreign to them, but Jesus is preparing them. For after he pays the price for something that would be possible, that wasn't possible at the time. It was not possible for them to dwell in God and for God to dwell in them. But he's preparing them for the new covenant. And so the moment that we get born again, those of you watching, if you're born again, if Jesus is your Lord and Savior, then you are in Christ and then you're abiding in him. Now there's different levels of intimacy that we can reach as we abide in him. But in the sense that you're born again, you're in Christ and you're abiding in him. And that's part of, just by saying, Jesus, come into my life, I give you my life, and you receive him as Lord and Savior, something happens, old things pass away, all things become new. And instantly you're born of the Spirit. And as a born-again spirit being, you step into the body of Christ and you call the body of Christ, you call a Christian, you're now abiding in him. So he says, if you abide in me, and then he says, and my words abide in you, we're going to come back to this. You will ask, and in brackets I put the Greek meaning of the word, you will ask or you will require, demand, and command. That's what the word ask more literally means. You will ask, require, demand and command what you desire or what you are determined to have, and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. So he considers having all the things that he's promised us. When we step into having those things, the Lord translates that and he says that's bearing fruit. So now let's look at this and break it down. He talks about asking or requiring, demanding, commanding what you desire or what you determine to have, and it shall be done for you. And people talk about this in prayer. And he says, well, whatever you ask, it shall be done for you. And it's not just the case of whatever you ask, it shall be done for you. How many watching online have asked for things and it has not been done? Yes, you own it, but you're not occupying it. You ask and you ask and you ask and you ask. And some of you even command, and some of you even require, and you're determined to get it, and you haven't given up. Well, praise the Lord, that's good news. But the fact is, many times you come up empty-handed, and sometimes there are people that even have backed away, and their faith has been hindered, because they've had the confident expectation that they'll walk in something, and yet it seems like they keep being bypassed. And then eventually it's like, well, then I don't even want to believe for it anymore, because I don't want to be disappointed one more time. There's so many people out there, it's like, well, I don't want to be disappointed one more time, so I'm not going to ask anymore. I'm just going to be content. And so people give up on their promise because they've been disappointed so many times. Well, I don't really understand it. I see somebody else asking, and then they have it. And somebody else asking, and then they have it. And it seems so easy for them. And yet here I am. I've fasted and I've prayed. I've shouted from the rooftops. I've prayed in a loud voice. I've had 10 other people come in agreement with me. The Bible says where the two or three are gathered, he'll do it for you if you ask him. I'm praying together, and it's just like it keeps eluding me. I don't understand it. I know God is a good God, and I know he's not a liar, but for some reason, it's just not materializing. Well, maybe there must be sin in my life, or maybe there must be something that I've done to disqualify myself. And people go down that line, and then false doctrines come out. Well, it's not God's will to heal anymore. It's all those things are birthed out of frustration of somebody who once believed. Believing is not everything. It's very important, but it's not everything. Jesus here is speaking about and speaking in the New Covenant terms. And as we look at the scripture, very, very key that we impart this. And I don't know how far I'm going to get with today's message, but I just want to take my time on this point because I feel like this is something the Lord wants to get across. We're abiding in Him. We're asking. To some of us are even requiring and commanding. It's not that you're commanding the Lord. It's like you're commanding your body, be healed in Jesus' name. Some of you, even the determination levels have been right up there. So we're asking, we're in Christ, but yet the bottom line is, it says it shall be done, but it's like we're not experiencing it. But when we read the scripture, it's not just abiding in Him. It's not just abiding in the vine. It's not just praying correctly. But he says, if you abide in me, and, say and my words, abide in you. And that's the part where we miss it. Right there. We are abiding in Jesus. We're praying a prayer of faith. But our word level is super low. Word's not abiding in us. And there's probably the highest level of resistance to getting the word on the inside of you and getting the word on the inside of me than any other kind of spiritual resistance. The devil does not want you to get the word on the inside of you. He'll let you pray. He'll let you come to church. But when it comes to getting the word on the inside of you, there is tidal wave opposition to the mission. Because the word of God is alive and powerful, and it's every promise of God in seed form. But it's the implanted word that has the power to save our soul. It's the implanted, indwelling word, abiding on the inside of us. That's what it's all about. It's that word. The word of God is like the engine in a vehicle. You can have the gas, you can have the driver, you can have the wheels, you can have everything, but if the engine is missing, it's not going to go anywhere. Your prayers, your desires, your requires need something to mobilize, and it's called the Word of God. And so therefore, when Jesus is saying, when we have the Word dwelling on the inside of us, then at that particular point, when we start asking or requiring or commanding, then it's not just that we're speaking into the air, and it's not that we're speaking to God out there in heaven somewhere, but it's actually we're activating the Word on the inside of us. See, as the Word comes on the inside of you, that Word is seed, and it is your healing in seed form. It is your provision in seed form. It is everything that you need for life and godliness, every promise in seed form. But it has to be activated. Say activate. But here's the thing. Even before it's activated, it has to be planted. And so we don't want to activate it in the seed packet. It's got to get on the inside of us. And right now, what we're really talking about is the planting of it. And then you have the activating of what's planted, the activation of what's planted. But if there's no seed in the ground, there isn't going to be a harvest. You are the ground. And you have the Word of God, you have the seed, you have every promise given to you, but it's given to you in seed form. I have every promise, we have every promise given to us in seed form. And so, in order to go from ownership to occupation, we have to increase our word level on the inside of us. And well, how do you do that? Well, we've been talking about that. When you speak the word, when you confess the word, when you declare the word, with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation, the Bible says. Unto prosperity, unto healing, unto provision. With the mouth, confession is made unto sozo. So when we go and again, there's going to be high spiritual resistance to this. Your flesh doesn't like it either, by the way. But when you come up and you declare and say with your mouth, by the stripes of Jesus, I have been healed. I have everything that I need pertaining to life and godliness in Jesus' name. I walk in wisdom in Jesus' name. I walk in divine ability in Jesus' name. I lay my hands on the sick and they will recover in the name of Jesus. And you speak and release that word in seed form. Now all you're doing at this point is you're getting the word on the inside of you. That word is alive, and so it starts living. The word that's sown into you starts living on the inside of you. This is a prerequisite to answered prayer. It's a prerequisite to occupation. When that seed is sown, and to the point where the word dwells in you. It's a living word. Dwells. Hallelujah. You're receiving this.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, besides your own confession, I mean, whatever, those of you in church here today, the word is being sown into your heart. So that's why, I mean, every time church doors are open, get in church. And I'm telling you right now, there's a different level. Even those of you watching right now, you're being the seed of the word of God is going on the inside of you, but it's not the same as being in the house. Not the same. It's powerful, it's anointed, not the same. You have to get in under the spout where the glory comes out. Hallelujah. You can experience what it's like to climb Mount Everest by watching somebody climb Mount Everest to a certain degree. But it's not climbing Mount Everest. When you're up there, I would rather watch it, thank you very much. Some things I'd rather watch, but what I'm just saying, it's different. You can watch a whole thing about people being underwater and snorkeling and how beautiful the ocean is in Technicolor, and it's wonderful. You can watch a football game on television and it feels like you're there, but you're not. And so it's a partial experience that you're having. It's so partial. I mean, instead of the whole bucket being dunked over your head, you're drinking it through a straw. Thank God for straws, and thank God for, you know, so praise God. I'm just saying, I didn't plan to say this, but by the power, I'm just felt led of the Lord to say this. People today in mass are staying away from church. And they're like, well, I'm just going to stay home and watch it. It's not the same. You are allowing yourself to be shortchanged. It's better than not watching it to watch it, but it's not the same. I mean, drag your sick bed with you, and whichever way, you'll probably walk out carrying it. There's that hunger and thirst where, you know what, the times when people used to come and line up before the church doors open, and I mean, today it's just like, well, we're going to make a cup of coffee, put our feet up, and just watch it. It's not the same. There's an impartation and a level of impartation of the word that's happening in this house right now to those of you that have made the effort to get here that is on a whole different level. Those of you watching, you're drinking through a straw. Those of us in here, we're getting a deluge. The bucket of the Holy Ghost is getting dunked on our head right now.
Amen.
And it feels good. I'm telling you right now, it's awesome. Thank you, Lord Jesus. No substitute. And then, I mean, I remember with the beginnings of the Word of Faith movement, people would they'd go in and remember the cassette tapes. Some of you are too young to remember that, what a cassette tape is. But they'd get the cassette tapes, and before that, the 8-tracks, and now we're really going backwards, and get the messages. I mean, right now, it's on Facebook, and then in a little while it's going to be on YouTube, and you know all those, and you can watch it and listen at the same time. But they'd get the cassette and listen to Kenneth Copeland and Kenneth Hagin and Oral Roberts and all these guys, and listen to it over and over and over and over, and carry it with them, put it in their car, and listen to the word over and over. What were they doing? They're getting the word planted on the inside. You're sowing it. You come to church, it's sown on the inside of you. You come to a meeting, Then you go back and then you listen to now it's a CD or a DVD and listen to it over and over. And it's the sowing of that word. It's building your word level up. And I'm telling you right now, there is a difference. The prayer life of somebody that has a higher word level is totally different than somebody that has no word level. Right. You can be a believer. You can own everything that God has freely given you, but you're not going to occupy much. I mean, unless it's just a miracle occupation where God just says, you know what, in spite of the fact that you've got no word in you, I'm just going to do this miracle just because I love you. And God is, you know, he's certainly allowed to do that. But for the most part, he wants us to grow up. And so therefore, when you take the time to plant the word on the inside of you, to speak the word, to sing the word, to pray in the Spirit, which is speaking the word on the inside of you, and you just keep getting the word, getting the word, getting the word, getting the word on the inside, 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 that word's alive. It starts dwelling, it starts living. All of a sudden, vision starts popping up, and now you're seeing things that you didn't see before. You're dreaming about things that you haven't dreamed about before. All of a sudden, the word faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word faith comes up. And it's like, wow, I never really believed for that before like I'm believing for it now. All of a sudden, it's like something alive. It's you've got something in your belly that's alive. And it's your promise. It's your inheritance. It's everything that God's given you on the inside of you. And now, with that happening, I'm in Him. And His Word is in me. And I'm up to Him with His Word. To a point of overflow. Now, all of a sudden, on the inside of me, something rises up. It's not just a dead word, but it's a stirring. It's a requiring. It's a command. Body in Jesus' name be healed. In the name of Jesus, you will go to the next level. You walk in favor in Jesus' name. You point to that sea and you say, in the name of Jesus, part. Water come out of that rock in Jesus' name. Mountain be moved in Jesus' name, be cast into the sea. And all of a sudden, it's not just empty, it's something. Now you're accessing the promises on the inside of you, and now you're calling it forth. You're calling forth those things that be not as though they were. It's a promise of God on the inside of you. And all of a sudden, it's by faith. It's not the same. You're not praying the way other people pray. It's something, you're accessing that spring, that fountain on the inside. And it does, when the man of God or the woman of God comes to town and they pull a healing line or pray, you're not coming forward the same way everybody else is. You've got a high level of expectation. You're full of the Word. You're in Christ, the Word's in you, and you're running over with the Word, and all of a sudden, you come forward, and you pray for people in prayer lines. You pray for one person, and it's like you lay your hands on a wall. And it's you pray, Jesus! You can shout all you want. It's like you're laying your hands on a wall. You get somebody who's full of the Word. It's Jesus. They're like, ah! Goes right in, and it's like the person next to him said, wow, I've been living a holy life. I've been praying. I've been fasting. I want that. I wonder if he's offended at me. And the devil says, yeah. You thought you were forgiven, but you're not. You disqualified yourself way back in he lies. It's not even about that because it's all under the blood of Jesus. It's just your word level's low. You haven't given God anything to work with. You just want the preacher's anointing and their faith and whatever they have, you want that to get on the inside of you and do the job for you. And sometimes it does, but many times it doesn't. You come to service and say, boy, it was boring today. And somebody else comes and said, boy, my life was changed today. The person who thought it was boring, you have a car, but it's missing an engine. And it's boring to sit in a car without an engine. You get a motorcycle, it can be the nicest motorcycle in the world, but if it doesn't have the engine, I mean, you want to start it up and you want to experience that engine kicking in. And there's people that come all the time and come and they have they're involved in a dead religion. And I'll tell you right now, if you're going to be involved in dead religion, it's better to just go to some place that doesn't believe anything. Just go to a social club church.
Yeah.
Just go there. Because at least you're going to have nice music and there's going to be some smoke coming out of the stage and people are going to be, you know, it's going to be good. Just go there. At least you're going to come back with some people patting you on the back and some good social. You'll have some hot dogs to eat or whatever. But don't get around people that preach the word. Because you're just going to get frustrated. You're just going to hear about all the promises and all the blessings and the power of God and everything else. And you can, it's only so long that you can sit down and listen to all of that. Listen about how everybody talking about how good the ice cream is. And you just have to watch them eat. There's a certain point where you're not going to go to that ice cream place anymore. I don't go to Baskin Robbins, whatever it's called, Baskin Robbins. I don't go to the Waffle House because I can't eat anything there. Well, if I do, I'm highly allergic to whatever they serve. I break out in fat immediately. And so therefore, I can't eat any of that stuff. So if I go and I just sit there, I can do it maybe once and just sit and pray in tongues the whole time. But pretty soon it's going to be a miserable experience watching everybody just feast on all the stuff that I'm allergic to. And you get a bunch of skinny people eating stuff that if I take one spoonful, I won't be able to walk out the door. I'll instantly go from walking to waddling. So I don't want to hang around there. And that's why some people say, well, why don't people hang around churches with the power of God? And why aren't those the biggest churches? Because people are frustrated. They don't want to be there, see everybody else get the miracle, see everybody else get breakthrough, see everybody else get blessing. Oh, give me a testimony. This promise happened to me. And that breakthrough. And praise the Lord. If there's a prophet, then that's the person that gets prophesied over. Why do they get prophesied? Not me. And then it's just like, who wants to be in a place where you're constantly missing out? So if you're not going to have a higher word level, just go someplace dead. That doesn't believe anything, it doesn't preach anything, and at least you'll walk away with a handshake. Hallelujah. And if you're like that and you want to stay like that, don't come to Amazing Love. You'll be so miserable. Because we're extreme. We're extreme, over the top, completely. If God said it, we want it all, and then some more. Well, God, you said I can have this, but I want more than you even said. That's how we are. And we get it too. And if you're not going to get in line with that, you don't want to come here because you're just going to get jealous and frustrated and feel very, very dejected. But God's not rejecting you and He is not passing you by. He's standing by and He wants to bless you and He wants you to go from ownership to occupation. But it's if you abide in me and my words abide in you, get the word level up.
Yeah.
You want the promises of God operating in your life? Get your word level up. Get back to like the early days of the word of faith. Find a way. Get it recorded. Listen to it over and over. Go find Rob Thompson online, his ministry, and go order his tapes where the word's been confessed over and over. Get Gloria Copeland healing tapes. Play it in your house. Play it in your car. When there's a meeting, get there half an hour early, an hour early. Run to the open doors. Get there. Sit there. Receive a double portion. Go out. Get more word. When you go to bed, plug in the CD or whatever. Listen to it while you sleep. More word, more word. Get to where you're constantly overflowing. And immediately, as soon as you do that, it's so easy. Father, in Jesus' name, I come in agreement with your word. And in Jesus' name, then you just call it forth. So I've never spoken to a mountain. Again, I said I had a lot of other scriptures I wanted to give you, but I've given what I feel the Lord wants us to have here today. You just pray a simple prayer. And by requiring and commanding and speaking, it doesn't mean you're shouting. It's just sometimes a very soft prayer. Thank you, Jesus. I receive that. I require that in my life. I think I'll have some. In other words, requiring something is just another way of saying, I think I'll have some. I think I'll have some of that. I think I'll have some of this before you leave to go out of ministry. I think I'll just have another portion of your anointing. I think I might just take some of that with me and go deposit it on somebody. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Is that song that talks, whatever you may need, just say it's mine. That works if you're full of the word. But if you're not full of the word, you can say, well, it's mine, it's mine, it's mine, it's mine. And it'll never be yours. It'll be yours in the sense that you've been freely given, but you won't walk in it. Hallelujah. And I don't know about you, but I want to walk in it. I'm so stirred up. I'm telling you right now. Even though I've been doing this, I'm going to just double up even more. Double up even more. And just get that word level increased. Just get that word level increased. Get that word level increased. Because the Spirit's there. Huh. But then it's like when everything starts working together, you're praying in the Holy Ghost. Boy, that's pretty water on that word. Whew. Hallelujah. God is not a liar. And what I just read in John chapter 15 is not a formula, but it's Jesus instructing, this is how you bear much fruit. This is how you do it. You're in Christ. You're full of the word. And now you ask. Now you command. Now you require. Being full of, and it shall be done. 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 God said, light be, light was. God, the word himself, Jesus, full of the word, said, light be, light was. He said it, then he saw it. I'm telling you right now, you be full of the word and in Christ, and you do just the same thing. You say it, and then you see it. You say it, you see it. You say it, you see it. And your days of lack are over. So what? Isn't God pleased with me having just a little bit of lack? No, he gave his life so that you could live in abundance. Yeah. I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Yeah. Yeah. Abundance means plentiful, lots, overflowing. Yes. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I need to just show the Lord that I'm just content with less than the best. He's not pleased with that. He says he's glorified that you bear much fruit. Not a little bit, much. In other words, he gets excited to be glorified. Means he makes himself manifest. He actually, when we start receiving his best, he actually comes in the room, manifests himself together with all of heaven.
Yes.
Wow. Look at my children. They're operating in my DNA. It's like we operated. They're operating like us. They are kids. As a parent, when you see your kid do something that you did, it feels good. It's like, wow, it is my son. Often I hear things Nicholas did and said things. Then he says to me, he says, well, Dad, I guess I am your son. Why am I surprised that I did this? I love him. He can say that 20 times a day. I love him saying that. It's just like, yep, chip off the old block. That's how God feels about us. When we start doing and operating at that level, he just sits back and he's just like, it's my son. Chip off the old block. It's my daughter. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, in the name of Jesus, get full of the word. And then begin to operate in that word. Begin to call forth some things. Go from that promise. Go from that hope. From that desire. Go from ownership to living in it, to occupation. I see you leaving the wheelchair behind and walking. I see you straightening out that crippled arm. I see you shaking off those headaches. I see you walking away from that depression. In Jesus' name. God bless you. We love you. Hallelujah. See you next week.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.